Come to beastofwar.com and comment every day for your chance to win two-player Mega Bundles.
Hey everybody, I am joined in the studio, well, live and digitally by some guests. So, we of course have John, we have the mighty James himself in, you know, Oriskany, and then we have Phil Yates up on the screen. Morning Phil, or is it good night there?
It's evening over here, yep.
All right, so Phil, we've brought you in to actually have a chat about what's happening with the new 4th edition rules for Flames of War. So, we've got a few questions, so anybody want to actually pick one out and go for it first, what they're curious about?
Sure, I'll go ahead and kick it off. Go ahead. I always was kind of curious, Phil, like what are some of the biggest changes that we see between version 3 and version 4?
Well, the biggest changes are around the unit cards. We use those to simplify everything, and that's a great one. Army construction is different. The way movement works, the way melee works, artillery, and missions. I suppose would be the big things that have changed most, I think.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, see, it's nice to know that the rule systems have been tightened up, because one of the things in Flames of War 3rd, I'll be honest here, Phil, I was always mildly intimidated by Flames of War 3rd, because it was just, where's my jump-off point? So it's nice to see that it's all tightened up and people are able to just jump in a little bit easier there. Mm-hmm. So how do you go from almost a 300-page rulebook to one that I think is a little over 100 points now?
Pages, you mean?
Yeah, pages.
100 pages and 100 points. The answer there is going back to some of the answers to the first things, is that we looked at everything in there and brought it all down to what's essential. So the unit cards were a key part of that. By taking a lot of the complexity out of the rules and putting them on unit cards, we're able to get a lot out of the rules. And the other thing we did was just look through every single rule in the rule book and decide what was important in there. So for example, if you think about hit allocation, in the old version 3 rules, that was 6 pages. Now, that had evolved from the original half a page in the version 1 rules long ago. And they worked okay, but there was a few situations when they just produced odd results. So the version 2 version got a bit longer as we fixed some of those problems. And then the version 3 one got longer again as we tried to fix some more of those problems. Mm. So by the time we got to the end of version 3, it was 6 pages, but still didn't necessarily work properly in all situations. So we stopped, had a look at that whole thing and thought, what do we actually want to do? And cut it right back. And again, hit allocation now is, it's on 2 pages, but it's pretty much comes down to 2 paragraphs. So we just took all of the complexity out and just went straight to a much more intuitive system that produced the result we want and produces at least as good a result as the previous one, and in many cases a better result.
Fantastic.
Other things we did was we took out all of the flavor text from the actual rules. Previously, we'd have a bit of flavor text in the rule, and that seemed like a good idea, except beginners would read the flavor text and pick a sentence or something out of that or a phrase out of that and go, oh, but how does that work in the rules? Because, you know, it was just trying to give people the idea of what was going on, but it wasn't necessarily 100% correlated to the rules. So now we've just got the rules, nice, clear, and simple. And if you're a beginner, you just read the rules, you know what you're talking about. Where there is a need for a bit of explanation, we've got a little dialogue box off the side where we explain what's going on and talk about it there. Yeah, so that's the keys of how we cut it down, basically.
Oh, fantastic. It sounds like people are going to be having a lot more fun and a lot less confusion in their games, which is always, always great.
I'll say this much about Phil was mentioning the unit cards, and what an improvement that you don't have to have this very large 300-page rulebook open on your table on your terrain, knocking tanks around, things like that. Yep. Unit cards are a very handy little thing, and just a quick heads up. I mean, when Phil's talking about like the new rules for hit allocation, for example, are down to 2 pages, and then he says it's really like 2 paragraphs. Yeah, it's not like 2 solid blocks of text. You know, it's a lot of great illustrations, a lot of great examples, a lot of great graphics to really, you know, the picture is worth 1,000 words, mm-hmm. kind of a yeah. Idea.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. We try and make sure that every important rule has a photograph with a cartoon style dialogue on it explaining how the rule works. So if you really want to get the basics and don't want to read a lot, just read all the pictures, and that will sort of give you the cartoon comic book version of the rules, right. But it'll cover most of it.
I guess that's going to be the one for me. I like looking at the pretty pictures. So, Phil.
I also forgot to mention, if you are getting started on the rules, there's 6 pages at the beginning of the book which tells you all of the rules, or all of the important rules, in 6 pages. Mm. So if you're going to start playing, read those 6, start playing, and then go back and read the rest of them. It'll make more sense that way, because you'll have a game under your belt and sort of an idea of what's going on.
Yeah, all right. So the next question that I'm going to chuck out here, because I've been far too quiet so far.
A little bit.
You know, Phil's here, and I
should... Oh, John, you can do that.
I have to man crush all over you. So, I've just said that on camera.
Internet is forever, but that's okay.
So why change the way people build their armies to the new force and formation structure, Phil?
Okay, the reason for that was basically it comes down to flexibility. But by that I mean flexibility in 2 directions. Flexibility to create the historical forces that you've been reading about and want to field, and flexibility to field the toys you want to field. It's a game of toy soldiers, so it's about getting the toys you want on the table. Now, under the old system, basically if you wanted to build one of the forces that Weird described in detail, you could. But if you wanted to get a little bit off to the side from where we were, you were quite restricted. So what we've done now is cut the cores back down to what's actually in your company. So you've got a panzer company that's got tanks. You've got an infantry company that's got the infantry. They're supporting guns and mortars and things. And then you pick whichever one you want, or multiple of them. You can have a tank company and an infantry company. And then you add to that your support. And unlike the way the old system worked, where it fairly much actively discouraged multiple companies, it's based on the idea that you're welcome to, and it can be quite useful to take multiple companies. So say I take a panzer company, want some infantry support. Well, I can just take a panzer company and as support, 1 infantry platoon. Then I decide, no, I really need a 2nd infantry platoon. No problem. I change that infantry platoon into an infantry company. So I buy a 2nd platoon and a headquarters, and bingo, I've now got 2 formations. And that just gives you the flexibility to build the forces how you want. And plus, you've got all the support you need behind that. Right, and the good thing is, you can actually build that out of the book. Or, if you've got the cards, on the back of the cards is all the information you need. So you just go, okay, I'll have this card, this card, this card, this card. Add them all up. And as James was saying, lay the cards out on the table and you're ready to go.
Fantastic. Right. One of the questions I have is how movement has been changed, because movement in Flames of War 3rd edition, there were a lot of different things that could sort of affect you. The different terrain types, doing your boggin checks, you know, all these kind of things that sort of, it's what I call speed bumps in games. So I'm wondering how you guys have maybe went back and shown some love to the actual movement rules for Flames of War 4.
Yep. And I'm going to keep coming back to this, it sounds like. The unit cards are part of the key there, because by having a unit card, we can have the characteristics of each unit very explicitly different. So instead of having movement categories like you've got to be fast, or you've got to be slow, or you've got to be light, or standard tank, or whatever, every single tank's got its own movement line, its own tactical speeds, its own dash speeds, and so forth. So whatever that tank's capability is, it's now reflected on the card, which makes things a lot easier. You don't have to look up tables or remember anything. It's all there in front of you. Mm. Now, I was talking about tactical speed and dash speed. That's one of the big changes. Dash speed is sort of like the old at the double. But when you moved at the double, you used to get shot more. Now, when you're dashing, you don't get shot more. You basically end up taking the same amount of fire. So it's much more practical to move fast on the table than it was before. So you can end up with a lot more sweeping maneuvers and so forth. At the same time, we brought all the tactical moves a little closer together. So the top-end stuff, like, say, a honey tank, is a little bit slower, while the infantry are a bit faster, which means at tactical speeds, things sort of tend to move quite sort of nicely. And the net result of that is that the games tend to feel like they've got more maneuver in them. You can feel free to, okay, I need to get out on that flank, or I need to get close. I just take a dash move quite fast, and that's just, there's no consequences for that. You're also talking about bogging down and so forth. That's another one of those rules we looked at and thought, this seems to be a very complicated sort of thing, really, when you look at it. Sounds simple, but in assaults, for instance, there were pages of rules about bogging down. So we thought, what happens if you don't actually bog down? You just stop moving. And so we said, okay, let's get rid of the whole state of bog down. So now each tank on the card has just got a cross number. And when you hit terrain, you roll your cross number. If you pass, you keep going. If you fail, you stop. That's it. No more consequences. So there's nothing to record, nothing to remember. You just stop moving. You can continue fighting in the shooting step and the assault step and so forth.
Nice.
I really like what we're talking about as far as how the tactical movement has become a lot more closer together. A honey or another like really fast tank is still fast, but not quite as fast proportionally as, say, a very slow tank like a KV-1 or something like that. Mm. And that's because it's not like the engine that's limiting the speed of the tank at that point. It's the caution of the crew. Mm. So that definitely sounds great. And like you were saying, I mean, I've seen games where this did used to happen a little bit in the older Flames of War, when firepower becomes so ascendant, nobody wants to move. And before you know it, everybody's undercover, everybody's got a little piece of real estate, and now it just becomes a slugging match.
Yeah,
and
or you find what happened to me during Flames of War 3 is that I would be very brash with five Panthers, go to charge them through a hedge, and four of them bog. Yeah. And I'm like,
and then they bump
but you're
the entire
a Panther.
Gear.
Yep.
No, it does.
So it's still possible, there. But of course, it just means that they hit the hedge and go, "We can't see how to get through here today. Yeah. There's more to this hedge than it looks like," and stop. But you can still keep fighting and so forth. But yeah, your Panthers are also quite capable of making nice, fast moves in other directions if they need it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Any other questions, gentlemen?
Oh, there was one other thing I was going to say.
Oh, go on.
And with movement, we've also added a thing called movement orders. Now, these are basically taking things like the old Stormtroopers move, the Avanti move, and so forth, and generalizing them so that everybody can do them. Now, the Germans are particularly good at doing, for instance, Blitz moves, which allows them to move before the start of movement, in a sense. So they can either pop out from behind a building and counter stationary, or get a extra movement and get ahead of the game that way. And they're good at that, whereas something like, for instance, a Crusader, which has got just a head down and charge tactics, not very subtle for that sort of thing. On the other hand, there's a follow me move, which is the come on lads, follow me. And somebody with a little more sort of bravery is going to do well at that, whereas somebody's a little more hesitant won't. And then you've got shoot and scoot, which is sort of if you didn't move, after shooting, you can try and duck back. And again, more skillful troops like the Germans are really good at that. Troops that are not so much into tactics will have a bit more difficulty with that. And by generalizing that, everybody gets to start playing with those sort of bits of cleverness, which adds quite a lot to the game, I think.
Nice one. All right, John, do you have any more you want to ask here?
Let me see here. I'm just having a look at what notes we have here as well.
Okay, you're taking too long, James.
Yeah.
There's been a lot of discussion about how some of the artillery has changed as far as how it affects different kinds of targets. Phil, could you maybe like expound on that a little bit?
Yeah. One of the things we wanted to do right at the beginning was definitely tone down the way artillery was working. It became through an evolutionary process where we'd put some stuff in the middle and then things crept up and up and up on top of that. It'd become very good at knocking out tanks and actually not particularly good at taking on infantry and guns, whereas it really should be the opposite way around. So we dragged down its anti-tank capability and boosted the firepower of the artillery and still didn't find it working fast enough. So we added another rule that basically says if you've ranged in on a target last turn, or you can actually range in before the game begins, at the start of the game, before you know where the enemy's going to be, you can actually put ranged in markers on the table. But anyway, if you repeat a bombardment on your ranged in marker, if the enemy's got some infantry or guns under that template, they're going to have to re-roll their saves. So sitting there under an artillery bombardment is not going to be a good thing for your long-term survival. But at the same time, we boosted the saves of guns and things. So, you know, it all balances out. But having some artillery to chew some infantry off an objective is a useful sort of thing. Or you can just go for the John-style thing of shoot them up and charge. But
either or fun to me.
It has its merits. All great battle plans are simple at the start. Just keep it.
Sorry. The other thing we changed was the way you range in now is you roll your skill check to range in, and then it's to hit based on the opponent's, the target's two-hit rating. So it's much more like normal shooting. And it was actually an oddity that caused it to go the other way, in that the way we were working things back in version 1, it became possible, if you hit it that way round, that you could artillery hit targets that you couldn't hit with shooting, and vice versa. So we changed it. And then, of course, it wasn't necessarily the most intuitive way of doing it, but you know, people got used to it. But now we've reversed it back to the way we wanted it to be. And the biggest thing that made that possible was allowing people just to range in anywhere on the table. You don't have to pick an enemy team as your target. You've got a lot more flexibility. And that just also got rid of a whole lot of rules and complexity. So you now just go, I want to range in here. As long as you can see the point, then it's just roll some skill checks to get ranged in and then roll to hit, almost like shooting what's under the template.
Mm-hmm. Which is the way it actually happens. When you're calling an artillery mission, you're not calling back to your battery saying, knock out that Panther out there. You're saying grid reference 85019, or you know, you're looking at a certain point on the map.
Mm-hmm. Cease fire.
danger close.
Check your fire.
but I mean, like, artillery, again, it was one of those things. The entire flavor of what I'm getting here is that the entire rule system has been stripped back, stripped down to sort of the core of what made it a good game.
It's gotten filtered down a little bit to where now I think the designers have a little bit more elbow room to put in some of the realism back into the game. Like Phil was mentioning before, artillery was getting to the point where it was excellent at knocking out tanks and not soft targets, when the exact opposite is supposed to be the actual reality.
Well, it's one of those things, you know, soldiers wearing helmets in World War II, that wasn't to protect them from bullets and rounds.
Exactly.
That was for shrapnel, wasn't it?
Shrapnel and debris. Yeah.
All right, we can move on.
Yeah.
All right. So, Phil, the morale rules look a lot less complex than before as well. Can you explain a little bit on how those have changed?
Yep. One of the things there, again, was just how can we make this more simple? The rules as they were before made it important to have odd or even sized platoons and various things like that. And people got, you know, when they're making their armies, quite awkward about, okay, well, I've got to make sure I've got four tanks in my platoon, not five and not three, or things like that. And we wanted to get rid of all of that and just make it really simple. So after looking at it, well, it came down to, if you have, say, what we did was tanks. If you've got two tanks still fighting in a platoon, it's fine. When you're down to one, the last one may run, and if any of them are bailed out, they may go with it. Likewise, infantry, get down to three teams, it's a problem. Above that, it's all fine. And this just, again, made things so much simpler. And yet, some people get worried about, oh, but what about the huge, you know, a huge Soviet company of 20 teams or something? We'll get it all the way down to three. Well, that's not going to be a problem with the mid-war stuff, because the ratings will change to adjust that. In the old stuff, we had to actually do quite a lot of kludges to get a big company like that actually lasting. So they tend to be fearless, which means you're going to roll a 3+, and then they get a commissar giving you a re-roll, and then a company commander giving you a re-roll, and so forth. So your chance of actually breaking is pretty small. And in fact, on average, you're going to end up in about the same position by the time the company's gone. And again, we'll be adjusting things when we get there to make this work really well. So it's actually not as sort of, people get worried about it because they're thinking in their head about how it's all going to work. But when you actually play it, it comes out really simply. Now, the other thing we've done is formation morale is really simple as well. If you've got two units still on the table, then all is good. So if you've got your commander in another unit or two units on the table, it's great. And just to help, you actually roll to remount tanks before you check to see where the unit's going. So say you've got a unit of four tanks and all four are bailed out. The first thing you do is try and remount all four of them. And if you get two of them back in, then the unit's not in poor spirits and it's not even taking a test. So the whole thing is quick, simple, works a lot better. And what I didn't mention there is previously you took a test at the end of the shooting step, you took a test at the end of the assault step. But now you only test at the beginning of your turn. You don't have to worry about those. And you know, I've been playing this game for 15 years, surprise, surprise, and I still would get to the halfway through the assaults and think, oops, hang on, we ought to have checked morale for the those tanks over there in the shooting step, and just forget that sort of thing. And it seemed to me quite common watching other games. So putting them all in one place at the start of the turn, just check to see if everything's okay before you get on with your turn, makes it a lot simpler as well.
Great, great. Right, now, one for all the new players out there, because new edition, people are going to be bringing in their friends. They're going to be saying, look, it's a new edition. You really want to try this. I know you stayed away from it before, but now is the drop-off point. Now is when you want to get in. Mm-hmm. Here's a question that I'm sure a lot of them are going to be asking, and that's why you use the two-hit number whenever you're shooting at someone.
Okay. I'll try and paint a word picture for this one, but imagine that you've got a horde of screaming conscripts charging across the field at you and you're behind a machine gun. Now, the amount of training you've got, as long as you know how to fire that machine gun, it's not going to make too much difference to the number of casualties they're going to take. Hmm. Plenty of targets, they're not taking cover, it's going to be pretty simple. On the other hand, if you imagine a bunch of elite commandos coming across the field at you, you're going to have trouble hitting any of them. Because, you know, the one pops up over there and is down before you can get them, then another one over there, then another one over there. So it's more about what the target's doing than what you're doing in terms of your ability to influence, to cause casualties. And if you think about it the other way around, it really doesn't matter who's manning that machine gun. Sure, some elite guys manning the machine gun will be marginally better than a guy who barely knows how to fire it, but as long as he can keep firing, it's not going to make much difference. So we took it that way and said, okay, really hot guys are hard to hit. Really crap guys are easy to hit. And it doesn't matter too much who's shooting. And that produces a much more realistic result, I think.
Cool.
Yep, absolutely.
So here's a question I've been thinking about lately. What kind of aspects of the Desert War, or either historically or tactically, kind of drew Battlefront to start the new edition at that particular place? In other words, you know, why Midwar and why, and especially why the desert?
Well, why Midwar is fairly simple. We've just come through about 10 years working on Late War, and it's pretty rich, deep, and complex there at the moment. And we thought, well, it's time to leave that and move on. We wrote the free rule book, which allows you to continue playing with your late war stuff and play V4 with it, and all those hundreds of different intelligence briefings and things that are available. Early war, we've also given quite a treatment over the last while, and it's pretty sort of well done as well. But it's been about 10 years since we really looked at mid-war. So it made sense to go back to mid-war and go, okay, let's take mid-war and, I mean, it was version 2 when we last really did anything with it, and make it something a little more up to date and really make it the focus of version 4. And the desert has a lot going for it in a sense. It's a nice little pocket campaign. So the amount of equipment on each side is relatively small, and so, and just somewhere great for us all to start, for the company because it's a nice compact thing, for beginners because there's not too many choices at this stage, but those choices still cover a lot of the possibilities that are actually out there. And of course the Desert War is iconic in a way. I mean, there's Alamein and just the whole Western Desert. It is one of the big things about Midwar. There's the Eastern Front, but that's a lot bigger and more complex, and we'll get onto that. But for the moment, we're just trying to get the desert sort of going.
Cool. Yes, I'm definitely a fan of the Midwar, definitely a fan of the desert, and I agree. Late War is great. It's when all the biggest toys are out there, you know, the biggest guns. But really, like almost like what we were talking about before, when the firepower gets so intense, when the ranges of the weapons get so intense, the movement tends to slow down to a bit of a crawl. So if
so
you've been
becomes a sniper matchup,
it starts to be So if you're a fan of if you want to give you know Flames of War a try, early war or mid war is definitely one of the more interesting.
Definitely. Yeah.
Although that does lead us on very nicely to one of the biggest questions that I know is on everybody's mind out there. What's next? You know, what factions are we going to be seeing coming out, Phil? You know, who do you want to visit and actually show some love to next on the list of Flames of War armies?
Well, we're working on the American book at the moment and an Italian book. And so they're coming out over the next year. And of course, the British book there is an intro to the British. There's no none of their infantry divisions are really covered there, so not the infantry tanks like the Valentine and the Churchill, and of course the Sherman, which is the bigger American tank of the period. The British haven't access to that yet, etc. So there'll be another British book as well. And once we've covered that lot, we're looking more at going on to the Eastern Front. So that'll be, you know, in a year or more's time, and we'll do some work on Stalingrad sort of era, bring out some more German stuff, bring out Russian stuff, T-34s, T-60s, KVs, all those wonderful things. So there's a long plan going all the way down, but the next thing you're going to see is Americans and Italians in the desert.
Awesome. Awesome. All right, any other questions, gentlemen? I'm jumping out at you.
No, I'm content.
You're content?
I'm very content.
I'm content. James?
My only remaining question that some people have actually been asking me at the boot camp is, with version 4 coming out for Flames of War, hopefully this will be a quick one, like what kind of release schedule can we see like over the next 12 months, and is this going to slow down any of the releases for Team Yankee, for example?
They're going to be interleaved, so you're likely to see something like a Team Yankee book, a mid-war book, a Team Yankee book, a mid-war book, but not literally that way. Sometimes it'll be one of, you know, two of one type, one after another. It depends on where we are in the schedule. So, yeah, they're both going to come out, and they're going to be, they're both going to come out, and they're both going to be sort of well-supported over the next while.
Well, fantastic. Phil, thank you very much for joining us.
One last thing. And this is for John.
Okay.
Oh, here we go.
I know you're a bit of a treadhead.
Yeah.
And one of the questions that some of the treadheads have been asking me is, why did we change the way we referred to the various panzers? Now, you'll know all about, you know, Panzer 3Js and Panzer 3Ls and Ms and Ns and all the other alphabetical ones. Those designations were largely used for production purposes. They're the factory designations. But when they got to the front line, they really didn't care what number or letter it was. What they really wanted to know was what it did. So if you look at all the reports, you'll see that they're referred to as Panzer III Kurz or Panzer III Short, Panzer III Lang, Panzer III Long, or Panzer III 7.5. And so we decided to adopt that sort of terminology because, one, it's historical, and two, it's actually much more easy for beginners to get into. And quite a few of the treadheads have been asking me that one, so I thought I'd throw that one in there, particularly for John.
Well, you see, I think this might make John sad, because he always loves just rattling off the factory numbers at me. What's the Hanomag, the late model?
Oh, the FDKFZ251/D.
There you go.
No, translate to English as half-track.
Half-track. No, it makes a lot of sense, because the terminology in the field was such because it was simple. You looked at the Panzer III, or you looked at a Panzer IV and went, short gun, long gun. I know what that does.
Das ist Panzer.
Yeah. Das ist Panzer, ist sehr gut, ja.
And some of these variants are so close together that it becomes to the point where it's like, you know what, that's really kind of the, you know, what are you going to start calling it? Panzer III/J/H/IBC. XD, you know, whatever, you know.
Yeah, yeah. And most of the time it was just down to something as simple as, well, we put six holes in the roadway instead of five, or there's a new air filter in the engine, or the engine block is slightly different.
Or guess what? We discovered Schürzen.
And that's a whole new model number, and you're like, really?
Well, even Schürzen would have some sort of a tactical difference on the table.
Yeah.
Whereas, like what John was saying, and even what Phil was saying earlier, is that a lot of the times it's literally just a manufacturing change.
Okay.
We can make this thing for 10% cheaper if we use five rivets instead of six.
Okay.
This is now officially the J instead of the H, instead of the I, the F, the whatever.
Got it. Yep. Got it. All All right, well, Phil, I think that's everything. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. Thank you for sharing all the new cool stuff that's happening with Flames of War 4th. We're going to get on here because we have games to play.
Okay.
So we'll like see you again sometime, mate.
Have a good weekend.
Thank you very much. See you later, guys.